Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Joining me tonight are Dennis Welch of the Arizona Guardian, Mike Sonics of the Phoenix Business Journal, and Luigi Del Puerto of the Arizona Capital Times. Good to see you all here. Thanks for joining us. Dennis, we'll start with the U.S. Justice Department filing a racial profiling lawsuit against Sheriff Joe Arpaio. Long time in coming, it was reported and suggested, and it seemed kind of obvious the way negotiations were going, correct?
Yeah, I mean, this is, you know, 4 years in the making at this point. I mean, you knew something was going to come, you know, come down. What's interesting about this is a, you know, this is they're suing him. They want to, you know, him to implement certain things and be able to get certain things. But it's not going to really change the way he runs his office, I don't think, in any time soon. Because, you know, I could see a lawsuit like this playing out over a number of years, a long time. He may be out of office by the time they settle something like this.
Indeed, this was as far as deputies discriminating against patrol operations, during patrol operations, discriminating at county jails, also the retaliation thing. It sounds like the sheriff doesn't have too much trouble with certain aspects, but boy, that court-appointed monitor is the real sticking point.
Yeah, that seems to be where he's kind of drawing the line and saying he doesn't want the feds essentially putting his office into receivership or taking it over. I think that's how he's trying to kind of play it in the political and PR world, is the Obama folks want to come in and take over a local police office. There's some pretty damning stuff in the report about the pulling over Latinos, I think 4 to 9 times as much as whites, you know, really targeting them in raids and warrants, in just their day-to-day activities, and then some of the stuff about the prison abuse, name-calling, and just mistreating folks that maybe don't speak English very well. But the sheriff centered on they're not going to come in here and take over my office.
Can that get him far as really, they're suing, but if they can get those talks back up going regarding that court-appointed monitor, this thing may never wind up in court.
Yes, that's true. If the sheriff at any point during the lawsuit agreed that he's going to allow that monitor to monitor his office, and then the lawsuit is dropped and they can find some settlement. So yeah, I mean, this is far from over. Dennis is correct. This would play on for a number of years, but at any point there could still be a settlement.
Him agreeing to give that up is just not going to happen. Can you imagine any scenario in which Sheriff Joe Arpaio says, yeah, I'm going to go ahead and capitulate to the federal government, and particularly any time between now and November? You got to remember that this is, you know, an election year. He's going for an unprecedented, a sixth term in office. I think this is right in his wheelhouse. I mean, he gets to take on the federal government in an election year. I think this is good for him.
I think both sides see political gain. Joe's going to get all kinds of money coming in from folks across the country that agree with his get tough stances on immigration and the green baloney and all that. He still gets plenty of capital from that. So he's taken on Obama. That's who he's taken on to the Republicans. And the other side, the Obama administration, this is going to help him with Hispanics, not only in Arizona, but I think other states, because the Hispanic activists and Hispanic community here and nationally have looked at Joe as an enemy for a long time. And they've wanted somebody to take some action. And even though this is a civil lawsuit and it's a political lawsuit, it's at least something that somebody's finally done. So I think this can help Obama, maybe in some other states like Nevada or New Mexico, Colorado.
But again, back to this court appointed, I want to get to the politics again in a second, but back to the court-appointed monitor. Why would there be a court-appointed monitor to oversee what you are doing if you are allowed to have a supervisory role or some sort of say against a court appointed? What's good with the court appointed monitor? What good is a monitor?
It ensures that the stipulation of whatever settlement is reached would be followed. That's the role of the monitor. It ensures that the sheriff's actually going to do what he would say, assuming he did say he would agree, that he would actually follow through.
So basically, the sheriff is saying, what, I don't care. He can sit there and watch, or she can sit there and watch, can recommend, can do. Just don't tell me what to do.
That's basically what it is, but in the way he's playing it out is like, look, I'm not ceding any of my authority, of office. I'm a duly elected, official. I'm not giving up any of my power, and I just don't see Sheriff Joe agreeing to give up any sort of authority whatsoever.
Especially once he's come out and said this many times on air to folks. A lot of political semantics in terms of what the monitor would do and what kind of power they have. But publicly, he's kind of drawn a line in the sand on that. I don't think he's backing down.
So back to the politics aspect of this. I'm going to fight this to the bitter end. Obviously, it's going to be throughout the election season. You've got the reports, the allegations, some of them. Apparently, the government still has a lot of stuff that they're not letting loose, and they're not going to let loose until they have to by way of the court. Will that stuff How does that play? Because, you mentioned earlier the two sides, but when you see those words in print, when you see those allegations in print, when you know the accusations of retaliation through the whole Andrew Thomas situation, we've heard a lot about this stuff. How does that really play in Maricopa County?
I think people hear what they want to hear on this. The people that like the sheriff see him being attacked by the Obama administration, who opposes 1070, who opposes the state's efforts to get tough on immigration. His critics see all the bad things that are in the report, targeting Hispanics, bullying them in a lot of cases, the retaliation against political opponents, people in the media. So I think both sides kind of hear what they want to hear on this, and I don't know if there's a lot of open ears on this.
Will you see many lawmakers, do you think, at the Capitol either rushing to Sheriff Arpaio or running away from Sheriff Arpaio?
I think those who have always been his allies would continue to be his allies. I don't see this as changing their attitude towards the sheriff. For his critics, of course, this is one more thing why they say he should be out of that office. But for guys who have always defended him, I don't think it changes the thing.
I don't think he has as big as coattails as he used to. I think he's pretty strong. I think, you know, he's certainly favored to win re-election. He's got a big war chest of money. He'll get more money in, a lot of small contributions from across the country from Republican stalwarts. But I don't, you know, he didn't help Russell Pierce withstand the recall. I don't know if he has those kind of coattails anymore. And that might be a function of all these stories.
He certainly doesn't have the coattails he used to have. I mean, even the polling suggests that. I mean, but he still has the kind of political popularity in Maricopa County that most political officials would kill for. But I think, you know, this does, again, you know, the accumulation of these types of stories continues to just chip away a little bit maybe at his support. Is it a game changer? No, this isn't a game changer. But it's that accumulation of these types of stories that continue just to maybe chip away at it.
Got a game changer in the CD4 race, Congressional District 4. Paul Babiou out. What's the story here?
Yeah, that wasn't a surprise. It was just kind of when it was going to happen after all the kind of scandal stuff came out about his personal life. And he kind of came up with this story that he'd be better serving his constituents to stay as sheriff. We've kind of seen this play out in other races where candidacies haven't worked out. Obviously, he lost a lot of fundraising, a lot of support after the stories came out about his background and his personal life and his background in Massachusetts. And that was going to be a tough race anyways with that district, the way it was spread out. So it's not a shock, but his story was a good attempt at spending something that wasn't too good for him.
I was going to say, one of his quotes were that the Pinal County residents were worried that his voice would not have the same kind of impact if he were back in Washington, which is one of the reasons he's going to go back. I mean, this really is retrenching and trying to keep what you got, isn't it?
I don't think that for those who have been watching this race and all his troubles and fall, I don't think those people believe that the reason why his suddenly shifting and deciding to seek re-election is because he's worried that he'd be just one of 435 people. I mean, you know, everybody says that at the end. There is another reason that he cited why he decided to stay in his office, and that's to have some continuity in his office. Basically, his deputy chief was running for sheriff, and it turned out that he cannot run and hold that position at the same time because of a federal law that essentially bans mostly federal employees from electioneering. And so he's saying, to ensure that there's some continuity in leadership, I'm going to seek re-election.
And this federal thing just popped up right now. The guy had been running for office for how long, and this just became an issue. I'm continually just always impressed with how these, you know, politicians think they can get away with this kind of stuff. I don't understand why he can't just come out and say, look, you know, it's going to be unwinnable considering what's happened, that my opponents came after me with these kind of dirty tactics, you know, that I'm going to be, you know, and I'm happy to continue to run again for a second term as Pinal County Sheriff. Mm-hmm. You know, because these kinds of statements, are, I think a lot of people see this and they're like, well, he's being disingenuous when he says stuff like this.
He's got other concerns as well down there. You got a state, Pima County, I believe, is looking into the idea of some problems as far as, was it electronic files being destroyed
There's
or something?
Emails, like that? Emails.
And then the feds are looking into whether the Hatch Act, you're talking about someone in the department was actually politicking and campaigning for him. That's on top of the whole boyfriend, whole, you know, whatever it is, the situation. I mean, can he win sheriff in Pinal County?
I don't know. I mean, he might be able to hold on one more time because of his name ID, and you know, he made a pretty big name for himself on his immigration enforcements before. But yeah, that's going to be a challenge for him, and we'll see what happens with the, you know, how these emails got destroyed.
I think if you look at it too, I mean, who's he running against? You go ask anybody who he's running against. I doubt more than 10% of people out there would be able to name that person. But so I think that shows that, you know, Paul, you know, he's got a good shot at winning election again.
He's got a good name recognition, but is it a good name recognition? They know who he is. Is that a good thing?
Well, let me say, as running for CD4 at this point is a non-starter. There's no way he can win that race, given all the troubles that he's facing. But running for re-election and explaining to people that already know him is much easier, and trying to, you know, to defend himself among friends, if you will, or among people who have already known him for quite a while. It's a much easier challenge than you know, running and explaining all your troubles in a very expansive district.
Well, it's the same thing as with Sheriff Joe. You got to give voters a reason, somebody else to vote for, and that's been a challenge with these races in the past with Arpaio, and I think it's going to be a challenge down there. Like Dennis said, you got to get somebody to say, okay, I can vote for this guy instead, and I know this guy, and I'll vote for him. Yeah. It's hard to get that those challengers.
And I think the question for Mr. Babu is if he is able to hold, you know, win an election again, is he's obviously got a lot of political ambition. That's really apparent if you look at his history. Can he now come back and over the next 4 years, 8 years, however he wants to hold this office or whatnot, resurrect himself, rebrand that image, and come back and make another run for a bigger office?
I don't think he can do that in the Republican Party. I just don't think the Republican Party of the state, in that kind of area of the state, I don't think you can do that. Now, maybe if he switched parties and moved to a more metropolitan area, Tucson or Phoenix, maybe.
What about the race in CD4 now? Head-to-head, Gosar and Gould. What are you seeing there?
I think Gosar has the big advantage there. He's the incumbent. He has that power. He probably has more. I think he has more money than Gould. Gould's a good conservative to a lot of folks, kind of an independent streak. If you look at the geography of that district, I think that kind of maybe benefits Gosar a little bit because Gould's more up in Kingman.
I think Gould can make a real good run at this now that he's gotten Babu out of the race. I mean, it comes down to Mojave County versus Pinal County. Mr. Gould got the endorsement of the Club for Growth, which is a pretty good big endorsement within Republican circles out there. That tells a lot of those people who in those donors that this is somebody you might want to invest in. So I think Mr. Gould can raise a little bit of money and take a shot. I still think the Ghosts are, because of the incumbency, because of the name recognition and money, is probably still a favorite this time.
All right, Luigi, we've got the governor signing a lot of bills here, vetoed one, which we can talk about as well, but the budget, we've got the personnel reform plan, all those things went through. Let's talk kind of a brief overview of them.
Yeah, the lawmakers introduced about 1,400 bills this year, which is pretty typical insofar as the number of bills that they introduced. They passed almost 400 bills. The governor's vetoed so far 19. She has a couple of bills still pending on her desk, and she signed 321 of them so far, including, of course, the budget, which is a 9-10 bill package, and, of course, her favorite, which is to overhaul the state's personnel system.
And as far as the personnel system is concerned, again, that makes new hires at-will employees. Proponents say it puts government workers at the same level as private workers. Opponents say watch out for cronyism, and some are saying you can already see that happening in certain aspects of state government.
Yeah, and this was the governor's number one priority coming. She'd talked about it in her State of the State speech. I mean, she'd been trying to get this passed for now for well over a year. She tried to get it passed in the last session. She was able to get it done this time. And I think, you know, it's a big expansion of power, I think, for the executive in the state for Brewer and governors moving forward to be able to, you know, have more authority to hire and fire the heads of state agencies out there. This is a big bill for them.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the governor's track record, she's very effective at getting conservative agenda items through there. And I know she's got both chambers, but still, there's always challenges with that. Abortion, taxes, and now this makes the government much more like a business. So I think she's been very effective at leveraging the majority she has and getting her agenda through and kind of picking her spots.
She was also effective in getting that sign ordinance changed to a way that would benefit more people. Talk about that. Again, the electronic billboard ordinance that she vetoed first time through, went ahead and signed the compromise, which is a word that we don't hear much, but there was compromise.
Yeah, initially, the governor vetoed the legislation out of concern that it would be a disadvantage to the astronomy industry in the state. And basically, we have a lot of observatories here. And if you have those lights on the highway, that might impact the way those observatories are able to look at the stars, look at the sky. They found a compromise pretty late in the session. Basically, it would limit those signs, those electronic billboards, only in certain areas of the state, away from those observatories. Also, there's a limit insofar as how bright they can be. And with those compromise, because, of course, the state's advertising laws, insofar as billboards, they need to get updated. They're quite old. So with that compromise, the governor said, yeah, I can live with that, and it's a good compromise, and she signed it.
It's a good win for the industry, too. They don't care about having billboards out by observatories. They want them in the Phoenix area, you know, off the loops and off the freeways. And that's where they want. They want them there. So you had they hired some pretty good lobbyists on the Republican side to get this through. And so it's a win for them. That's where they want the billboards. They don't really care about having them out in the rural areas. So I don't think they're too displeased by this.
Not a win for the idea of changing the definition of an intersection because of red light concerns. Governor said no way.
Yeah, she did veto that one. Usually, you know, the legislature, for as much as they hate getting mandated by Washington for things, they seem to try to push a lot of things on the cities. And this billboard thing kind of limits what cities can do. Well, the intersection thing that Antonori pushed, she vetoed that. So she's bucked the trend of her buddies in the legislature every once in a while.
And don't discount the politics of personality here when it comes to Senator Frank Antonori, who basically called the governor stupid, I think it was last year, the beginning of this year. You know, the governor's not going to take too kindly to people who treat her like that. I think, you know, some of that maybe may have factored in to her decision to kind of get this bill through. And also remember, you know, Mr. Antonori took a lot of political shrapnel, as it would, for running this bill at the same time he was fighting, you know, running red light tickets of his own.
So. And not only that, during testimony, the governor did mention that she wanted law enforcement's opinion to be considered more than it had been considered in this bill. And that kind of goes back a little bit to this altercation, confrontation, whatever it was, between Antonori and a law enforcement officer at the Capitol, correct?
And I don't know how much that played into it, but what's clear is that the governor said, unless you can get law enforcement to support this, I'm not going to sign it, period. And, of course, there's a little bit of history, as Dennis said, between Antonori and the governor. I talked to Antonori immediately after it was vetoed, and he basically said, you know what, the problem is, there's always been a lack of communication between the governor and lawmakers. We don't know if she's going to veto the bill. If she would just send, his words, one of her minions to the legislature and tell us and give us a note and said, you know, improve this or improve that, then we would have a much better result.
Well, the governor's
the verbiage is just so welcoming and so
the minions.
Who could be upset with something like that?
I think Mr. Antonori needs to look at, like, yeah, review some of his prior statements. He might have a better track or opportunity getting this bill passed.
Might get the floor somewhere.
Well, sometimes when the governor comments, if they comment early on these bills, any governor, it opens up a can of worms. I mean, I think you saw Janet do the same thing. They tried to defer comment as much as they could, because if they say one thing, then a lot of things break loose after that.
The mortgage assistance money that was swept in the budget. We're going to have Tom Horn on, Attorney General, this week to talk about this, because the money was supposed to go to him for a settlement, and the consent agreement was for it goes to foreclosure and housing crisis issues and folks. Legislature says that means us.
Well, the legislature decided that they can grab the money and spend it for whatever they want to spend it on. In fact, when they swept $50 million of the $98 million or so that we received a settlement, they did not earmark it for anything housing related. The condition, if you will, is that we would spend the money to ameliorate the foreclosure problem, and as you mentioned, anything housing related. I think the thinking is that if the Attorney General's office is just going to use it for counseling those who have already been evicted out of their office, I heard Mr. Pierce, the Senate President, say that, then, you know, let's just take the money and use it for whatever we want to use it for.
Republicans in this state, the governor, the congressional delegation, and the legislature have had such a tin ear to the foreclosure issue. I don't think they've passed one bill. I don't think they've done one thing. They've gotten money from the hardest hit fund from the Obama administration, and they tried to use that. They can't get the banks on board with that. The Brewer folks have done that. But the legislature it does not care about this issue at all. They don't care at all. They think the market maybe should just work itself out, and we'll move forward.
And this kind of stuff, like, when they do this, this is really going to help them out, Republicans out in an election year. I'm being sarcastic, I think, because, you know, lots of Democrats, after they went ahead and did this, were actually kind of smiling, saying, look, they've given this the perfect political issue in a political year to go to voters and say, look, like, you know, Mike said, the Republicans don't have your best interest in mind when it comes to this mortgage stuff.
And not only that, but if it goes to court and it's headed for court, it just gets elongated. It gets back in the headlines, and it seems like if you earmark money for a settlement for A, and you want to use it for the rest of the alphabet, some folks are going to wonder about that.
Yeah, and you know, it's $50 million in a big budget.
Yeah.
You know, why open that can of worms? And at least look like you're doing something. Everybody knows that this issue is a tough issue to deal with, and a lot of the programs have not worked. But I think politically and from everyday folks' standpoint, you want to look like you're helping.
And that's the question. Like, why would you do that? You've got over, you know, $460 million in the surplus that they stuck in a rainy day fund. Couldn't they have taken some of that money, $50 million for this mortgage sweep, instead of sweeping this fund and creating and generating all these negative headlines? It's just, it's baffling.
The Maricopa County says it wants to get involved with the lawsuit regarding the Independent Redistricting Commission. And you'd think, okay, someone else thinks it's a bad commission, bad is. They're saying, no, don't do this temporary one-time districting. Wait till after the election, then do your action. Was that a bit of a surprise?
Well, from their point of view, I mean, they don't care about the merits of the lawsuit. They just want to make sure they're able to do their job. And by their reckoning, they have certain deadlines they need to do. They need to print the ballots at a certain time. They need to send them out for overseas voters. They need to do all this stuff. And if you're going to make a change at this point, they think we're not going to be able to do our job. Essentially, we're not going to have an election. And obviously, that's going to be a problem.
Is that something that, where is that argument going, though? When the county election officials, and let's face it, most of the folk, those folks are do lean right, and you're talking about conservatives in the legislature not happy with the districting commission's work. When they're saying, just hold off a little bit, and you're still charging ahead, what's going on here?
Well, I think conservatives in the legislature are look at what the commission did, and they're blinded kind of by that. They see some of the decisions they made, especially hiring the Obama consulting firm, and just the lines they drew. They're not thinking about the kind of day in, day out of the election folks. And you're right, a lot of those election folks are Republicans, but they're more professional folks just running elections, trying to get the ballots out and everything. So there is that kind of maybe an ideological reality disconnect there.
You got about 2 minutes to explain why the new state parks director has no experience as anything in parks.
Well, because he has no experience in parks. I mean, he was picked more than 200 applicants for this job that pays about $130,000 a year. He didn't meet some of the basic qualifications. He was able to convince the parks board, who makes the hire, that, hey, you need a political operative such as myself to help get money for this agency that's been cut and abused over the past few years by this Republican legislature.
Well, he's tied into this mine down there in Florence, and the governor's tied into that, and Chuck Coughlin and High Ground are tied into that, and so it's all interweaved in that. So that's where kind of some of the cronyism charges pop up.
Interestingly, the governor basically said today she didn't know about it. She had her office had nothing to do with the hiring of the new manager of the state's park system.
Yeah, but they did hire the new parks manager, Brian Martin. The governor's office did hire his wife for a $40,000 a year job in constituent services.
Well, they can commute together, right? up to Phoenix, right?
So saves energy right there. Okay, real quickly, Coyotes. That sale going to happen or what?
Well, they announced a tentative deal in this ongoing saga. Bettman was here and he said, but there's nothing on Glendale's agenda next week. So it could drag on a little more, but they're in the playoffs. Maybe as long as they stay in the playoffs, the sale goes through.
I should ask a question. Will the Coyotes still be in Phoenix when Sheriff Arpaio and the feds figure out this whole racial profiling lawsuit?
Ooh, that's going to be tough. I'm going to say yes. I think they're going to stay here. The NHL's put so much money and energy behind this that they're going to stay.
All right. Thank you for joining us. We appreciate it. Monday on Arizona Horizon, we'll look at continued efforts by Arizona lawmakers to pass states' rights legislation. And we'll hear from the founder of Child's Play, a professional theater company celebrating 35 years in the Valley. That's Monday at 5:30 and 10 right here on Arizona Horizon. That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great weekend.